Last week I visited BSSC and had the opportunity, opportunity to meet with I think there were 30 top scientists, so it was a great pleasure. As there are no introductions, let me introduce myself to give you the perspective from which I'm coming. I studied physics and engineering, so I have a deep interest in science. But of course, what I'm going to do today is to give you an economist's perspective. So let's just start, given that we have... one of the things for us which distinguishes science from technology is something we call uncertainty versus risk. And uncertainty, the difference is that risk has a profile, a known profile. So you can have a broader risk profile or a smaller one. Those who have done probability and use it know what that means. Uncertainty means it's undefined. So that's one simple way in which I distinguish between science and technology. Technology has to be based on risk assessment and expected benefits and costs. So I will only be talking about technology today. So one of the... Sorry, did somebody say something? No. I think the setting up of the National Science Foundation is a very important development, because one of the problems, and I'll mention the context towards the end, which I have in my talks with various people come across, is this difficulty for bureaucrats and generalists to estimate the risk. So that's why I mentioned the risk to start with. And I'll give you an example of that later. And so it's very important that there be specialized experts who do make these judgments. Because it's all a matter of judgment, you know, because, you have a spectrum from uncertainty to high risk to medium risk to low risk. There are very few low risk projects. I mean, government actually need not get into those if they are low risk. The private sector takes care of it. So that is one thing. The second, I'll talk very briefly about the difference between commercial and strategic technology and the role of government, departmental enterprises and the private sector. Again, I think this economic perspective is very new. It's, as I understand it, the PM is very keen on bringing the private sector, so it's useful to be clear about what is it and why is it and where is it that each one has a role. And finally, I will talk a little bit about the dimensions of risk and some of the gaps in innovation ecosystem or weaknesses which I've kind of, in my very brief investigations, found. So this is just the perspective. I'm sure there'll be a lot of expert and discussions we'll have now, you probably had earlier and have more later. So the fundamental difference between commercial and strategic technology is that the former is connected with the general technological level of the country. It depends on the whole industrial structure, while strategic technology is very much driven by governments. We've all heard of DARPA, etc., but this is true all over the world, and it's true in history. So that is the basic difference. Commercial technology development is driven by the profit motive. Strategic has to be driven by the strategic, and that's what's happened in history. But of course, private decisions are affected by the government's macro policy. So that's where government, if it wants, can intervene. I just want to mention, I presume that this is some interaction with states, so I want to mention that states have an important role in supporting innovation. And the motivation should be because exporting firms are more productive and invest more in R&D. They also train and employ more skilled people. So this is research comparing exporting firms and domestic firms in the same area. And this is the result they find, that the exporting firms are more productive in these areas. So you generate more high-skilled employment in the state in which you promote innovation and R&D. And of course, I already mentioned strategic defense technology, but there is an economic concept here which is very important, which some of the people who advised on the procurement policy were not aware of, and that's why I want to mention it. Defense is basically what we call a monopsony. You know, the word monopoly means a single producer. Monopsony means a single buyer. This has important implications for a lot of things, you know. So when we talk about producing submarines or something, there's one buyer, okay? And that makes a lot of difference from the usual competitive commercial type of stuff. So it's important to keep that in mind. Obviously, technologists are not going to be using that, but then you have to consult an economist to know something, not a bureaucrat who knows nothing about it. That's the point only. And of course, dual-use technology is a little more complicated. Even the US is having great difficulty in defining the line between commercial and strategic, which is going on with semiconductors, etc. But again, my purpose in mentioning is not to give a whole lecture, but just to say that these are important things which have to be kept in mind when we make policies and act on these things. So very quickly, the role of government. Why the R&D and innovation has an important role for government? Because this is an area where there is the largest gap between social returns and private returns. So there are returns which dissipate in the society and contribute to the whole society and cannot be appropriated by the person who does the R&D and develops the product. So that is the gap. This happens in highways, for example. It's in many other things. But the biggest gap is in R&D. So that is why there is an important role for government, that it has to fill that gap if it wants. If it doesn't do it, then there'll be less R&D, there'll be less innovation in the whole country. So closing the social-private gap is one. And the second element is reducing risk. Risk means higher the risk, the more capital you use, etc. I'll say a little bit more about that later, but reducing risk is another. And of course, there are many methods, subsidies, tax incentives, etc. I'll come back to it a little bit, just to give you an idea. So role of private sector. So commercial, I already mentioned, clearly largely competitive creation and technology supply, okay? So they are efficient, they do these things generally. I'm talking about the world, we can come back to the weaknesses of India. The second one is kind of incomplete, that thing should actually read. It's monopoly, conventional monopoly, or based on IPR protection. So this is a kind of alert or warning, something again I've learned in the last year or so, that monopolies, whether they are due to being a single producer or some IPR which nobody else has, some of these companies may actually, and they are foreign companies, we don't have any in India actually, who have this kind of capability, that they may actually say, okay, we will buy your technology and then just kill it. Okay, so it may be in their commercial interest to just kill the technology. Now, as a country, we do not want that. We do not want any technology which we are making to go into the hands of such companies who have an interest. It's not ideological. It's commercial. Their commercial interest dictates that they just kill it because they'll destroy all the existing business. So this is something to be aware of. The cases which I've heard basically are in vaccines and biological, actual cases. I don't want to talk about those, but this is based on... So that is... just a thing to be aware of. Now, I mentioned dual use and strategic, and the whole debate actually is going on in the US right now, but the important thing here is that in dual use technology, you can unbundle it and introduce what we call benchmark competition. Sometimes it's very difficult to have competition in really strategic sectors, but in dual use, you can do that. That's kind of the characteristic, again, from a policy perspective. And I think some of you have actual experience where you are distributing and licensing it to private sector. So you would understand. And maybe, you know, if it's relevant to your address, you may take that up. What about role of DPDs? DRDO, I will put that as DPD, though it's not exactly, it's on the border. But the advantage is that you can attract risk-averse, high-quality, social-minded researchers. So in many areas, including DRD, other places, I've met so many motivated, highly motivated. They are not driven by profit. They are not driven by wages, but by something inside them. So the public sector, in a way, provides a home for that, you know. And then given government can think long term, it is what we call has a low discount rate or a larger horizon than any company or private, so, and low borrowing rate. So if it's very capital intensive investment or long duration, the government is better able to do it. And of course, government has low or zero default risk. But the disadvantages, I think, is very important to also be aware of. Bureaucratic constraints, parliamentary accountability, again, all those of you who have dealt with it know it. And this is perhaps you don't think of the narrow product focus. You see, a commercial company is always looking at different ways of using whatever they invent. That, as far as I have come across, is absent in public. You just focus generally on, okay, we have been tasked to do this, or you decided to do this, and you just focus narrowly. That's the general thing. I'm not saying everybody at all time does it, but that is the danger. Okay, a couple of slides more. One, I think it's, I've talked a little bit about it, but again, this relates to the previous one. There are really three dimensions of innovation. One is capital intensity. So, capital intensity, so that we have, let's say, the interest rate, which is government pays or government companies pays versus private companies versus SMEs, it goes on increasing. So, which means they pay a higher cost of capital. Government pays less. So, government is more able to do highly capital-intensive projects, where you have to bring together a lot of equipment, etc. Skill intensity has the opposite effect, generally, which we see across the world, which is that highly skilled, flexible startups are good for that kind of stuff, because they have that flexibility. They don't have that bureaucratic. And you will hear of many cases where, large companies, whether they are drug companies, Microsoft, etc., buy these small companies when they develop something. So that development phase is really very important to involve a lot of small companies if it's not very capital intensive, if it's skill intensive. And finally, the degree of risk. Again, obviously, government is more able to take high risk, high duration, and the SMEs much less. So overall, this is obvious, but let me repeat, the large public sector companies are probably should focus on highly capital intensive, long duration, risky projects, and intermediate, the large private firms, and of course small ones and startups in this restricted area. And of course you can unbundle and divide that up. And again, I'm very glad to hear that many people, including DRDO, are doing this already, which is good. But that's kind of the economics behind it. Last two slides, lab to market. So here is some of my learnings, and I hope to learn a little more from all of you. Is that there? I found that they are. We don't think finely enough that they are separate. Stages of risk. So proof of concept, prototypes, you go through 1, 2, 3. It's not just one prototype. You know, where I've talked to private firms who are doing innovation, this is a thing comes up. Or even professors in IITs, etc. This is, you know, the government generally thinks of it as a unit, but there are many stages and each requires its own kind of intervention or ecosystem. So different stages of prototype. At some point, whether you have to determine, okay, it's all prototype is ready, but is it a producible product in a factory? Okay, it's not just lab anymore, prototype. How producible it is, and of course, finally, how marketable it is. And each of these stages, I've discovered that some of the links have been built up, but some are still missing. Okay, so some places, the government funding, angel investors, venture capital are filling, but there are still gaps left in some of these areas. The risk appetite and ability of domestic companies is one, and this is the danger I told you about, that foreign companies, I find that many complaints I heard that they just don't get domestic companies, and this danger always remains that a foreign company will just buy it up and do nothing. The other aspect, which again I've heard complaints, is government procurement rules. So for example, If a small private individual or company develops a scanner, let's say for airports, all airport procurement is government, effectively. But their rules don't permit it. Okay? So it's very important where government is a major or sole buyer to look at all these procurement rules. Again, somebody like me doesn't know all these rules, but I'm open. This is one of the things I ask every visitor who comes to my office, that please tell me, where are these problems? Because this is something we can solve easily. You know, there's some. It's useless to keep having these things where we ourselves restrict purchase of developed technology. And then sustained IPRL help, again, it's happening. But the way this, our systems is that government funds for 3 years, then you say, okay, you are now on your own. So whether that help to IPR will sustain or not is still a question mark in my mind. So we must have sustainable system. You know, given 1.4 billion people, there'll be a lot of people who just do not have the funds to even have an IPR, which will then be picked up by somebody else. And then, of course, the rules on taxation. And one of the important things I find here is a bias against startups. Unfortunately, this goes is very deep. I won't talk about it, but I'll put it down. So here are a couple of ideas which I'll just lay on the table. Maybe people will not be addressing it today, but maybe later. Or anybody has ideas, I'm always open to it. One is the concept of a strategic technology commission, which actually... Professor of IIT Madras, who wrote a report in 2009, which started as, by the way, an analysis of DRDO, but his report was much broader. So he recommended the setting up of a strategic technology commission, which had covered all non-AEC, non-ISRO technology. The last finance commission, I wrote a note for the finance commission where I recommended that this commission have a non-lapsable pool of funds with some kind of a 5-year rolling allocation. And some of this has been done in some way since then. Flexibility is very important. I mentioned high risk and uncertainty. Because things are so uncertain, you need to shift funds away for things which are proceeding slowly and two things which are proceeding quickly. So there has to be somebody who has the knowledge and the trust to be able to do it. Otherwise, you have procedures which take years. It's too slow for technology development. You know, instead of developing in 5 years, you'll develop in 10. And some kind of flexibility. And finally, incentives, I mentioned, these are on the table, but again, we used to have something called a double deduction for R&D expense. At some point, it was abolished. There are new ideas which have come up. One I heard yesterday, which is about matching government grants to R&D expenditures of companies, because I think we do need to somehow incentivize greater R&D in the private sector. And another idea which comes from Israel, which I call it simply convertible equity. Normally we have something called convertible debentures or debt. This is the opposite of that. That is, government takes a share, and if it succeeds, they can convert it into debt. So it's not that you're forcing a partnership on them, but you're just making sure the incentives are right. That is, if there is a loss, you will take it as an equity holder. And if there's a gain, you don't get huge gains, but you make sure you get the funds back and can reuse it for other equity. Okay, thank you. I'm sorry I took longer than I intended, but unfortunately, being an quasi-academic, this is a problem I always have. Over to you.